question one, we have a I think this is your turn in the point material, for example, if you have a crystal, so typically for example, if you have a simple crystal structure like this one, and simple cubic means that anyway you have an entrance at all this corner, right? So all this will define a lattice. And then, so here anyway, we're going to deal with about this one. And we want to talk about, you know, the mathematics. So how do we define a lattice? Because you have many atoms, right? And then we define this lattice in a real space. So we have three vectors we call T1 and T2 and then T3, right? So once we have these three vectors, and then we can define another space we call reciprocal space. So this means that anyway, this is a physics, but now you only worry about this one. So we can convert this space into reciprocal space of this one. And then this reciprocal space will be defined by three vectors we call B1. So we have three vectors called B1, B2, B3. And so these three are related by mathematically. This is what we know learning mathematics will be used for. So this B1, this B1 is given by so T2, right? And somehow I can't cut up this. So but anyway, so in this case, we define this as T2, and then cross T3, and then divided by T1, and then dot T2 cross T3. B2 is given by so T3 cross T1. So T3 cross T1. And then T1 dot to T2 and then cross T3, right? So and then the third one is B3. So that this is going to affect itself. Then you have T1 cross T2, and then it's the same thing, T1 dot T2 cross T3. Okay, so that's basically how P1, P2, P3 are related to T2, T1, T2, P3, right? So this is for physics, and so we use this one because this real lattice is defined by this, and then reciprocal lattice is by this vector. If this is typical for you to understand, just think about Fourier transform. So Fourier transform, you have a signal in time domain, and then you transfer to frequency domain. So time domain and the frequency domain are opposite to each other, right? And then in physics, there's another Fourier transform. It's called from a real lattice, real space to reciprocal space. The real space is what we can see. And then reciprocal space is opposite of our real space. We cannot see it, but it's very useful. And so, in electronic materials, we use the lattice structure. So the lattice structure in real space, what you see all the atoms, right? But it's very difficult to describe electron behavior in real lattice. That's why we need the reciprocal lattice. So the receiver lattice is just opposite of the real lattice. So the real lattice is defined by T1, T2, T3, and then receiver lattice is defined by B1, B2, B3. If you look at the dimension of B1, B2, B3, you'll know that, for example, if T has a dimension of length, because this is in real space, right? And then you see this is length square, and then this length cube. It means that length square cancels with the one length square here, you stick out length here, right? It means one over length. So this means it's reciprocal, because whenever in real space, you measure by length, for example, you use a unit meter, right? And you go to reciprocal space, it's one over meter. That's called reciprocal space, okay? But here, we don't talk about this one, we only look at mathematics. So we have a three vector, T1, T2, T3, and then we can define the other three vectors, T1, T2, T3, by using this relationship. So now we have two different lattice structures. So for one of the lattice structures, and so T1 is given by, so that's the T state, right? Now, if you do this, and then we can try to find out what's the B1. And so, in order to find B1, so you have to find out the T2 cross T3 first. So this one will be, so you have I and TA, right? And then T2, so we just use A, okay? Don't use B1, B2, it's very complicated, just use A. And then you have A square, we just take out A square because it's A, both are A, okay? So T1, T2, A, just take it out. And then you have this T2, or 0, 0, okay, 0, 0, and then 1, 0, and then 0, 0, 1, right? That's what you have, right? So that's why this one usually have a square, okay? And so for y, x component have 1, and then y component you have 0, and then z component you have 0. You have, right? Okay. and then T1 cross, not cross, T1 dot T2 cross T3. Okay, so, and then in this case, you just define the dot product, right? So that's why you have a P2 over 2, and then root 3, right? Root 3. That's what I have. It's okay, right? So this is what it gives you. So now, somewhere here, otherwise I don't have a space. Right, so I just write here T3 cross T1. So T3 cross T1 and T3 cross T1. So again, I have a A square and so over 2, right? And so I have I. Here, and then 3, so I have a 001, and then cross T1, so T1 is a root 3, and then the 1 is a 0. So that's why I have a A square over 2, and so I have a minus 1, right? And minus 1. And then 0. Right? That's what I have. And then I have another one. Sorry, it's a bit messy. I just write here. So T1 cross T2. So T1 cross T2. So T1 cross T2. So again, I have a B square for 2. Then I, K, and so T1, so I have a root 3, 1, 0, T2, 0, 1, 0, so eventually, and so I have a D square over 2, and then a 0, and 0, right, and root 3. So if I have this one, and then I can write down B1 here. So B1. So B1 is T2 cross T3 divided by this triple product, right? Scalar triple product. So that's why I have B2. A squared is canceled out. And then I have B1, and then B2, so B2 again, B2, so T3 cross T1, so that's one here, right? So I have 1 over root 3, and then minus 1, root 3, 0, right? And then B3, so B3, T1 cross T2, so it's here, right? So T1 cross T2, and so I have 1 or 3. Of course, this can be cut out. You can try to simplify it. So if you simplify this line, you get the 0, 1. Sorry. There's always a A here, but because 1 is cubed, right? So it's always a A here. So this basically is a, you know, P1, P2, P3. So this is what you get, right? So this from this T1 is given, T2 given, T3 given, and then just find out P1, P2 by this definition. So once you have P1, P2, P3 in physics, and what happens is that you can use this one, and this one to construct a lattice. So that lattice is a visible lattice. Okay, so that's by physics. So next we'll look at B. So for this B, and so again we have a T1. So in this case, T1 is given by A or 2, and then you have minus 1, 1, 1, and then T2 is given by B or 2, and so T2 is 1 minus 1, 1, so 1 minus 1, 1, and then T3 by A or 2, and then 1 minus 1, 1, 1 minus 1, 2. So again, so we can find out so what's the B1, and then what's B2, and then what's B3, right? So B1, B2, B3 use the same definition, right? So similarly, in this case, we can find out what's the T2. So T2 cross T3, right? So T2 cross T3. So again, you have A square or 4. That's because you have A or 2, A or 2, right? And then you have I, K, and then K. So now you have minus 1, 1, 1. Sorry. 1 minus 1. So you have 0 and 2, right? 0, 2, and then 2, right? So that's for this one. And then you have, okay, next one, we calculate this. Next one will be T1. So T1 cross T2. So again, you have a B square 20 by 4, and then I is A. Alright, so, and the T1, so minus 1, 1, 1, T2, 1, minus 1, 1, so we have a square root of 4. Right, and then you have 2. This one also 2. And 0. No, 2. And then 0. Right? So now just find out this triple product. So T1 dot T2 cross T3. So you have a cubed 8, right? And then what is 1? So you have a 0, 0 plus 2 plus 2. So eventually you get the a cubed divided by 2, right? So that's why your T1 divided by and T2 cross T3 divided by this super product, right? So that's why you have 1 over 2, 8, and 0, 2, 2. So basically, it's 1 over 8, and so 0. 1, 1, right? And then your B2 so B2 be 1 over A 1, 0, 1 and then B3 be 1 over A and 1, 1, 0, right? So that basically this way. So again, you see that this has a this actually called translational unit vector for this real lattice. Of course, you have less the dimension or unit of this is less, right? And then you go to reciprocal lattice, this is 1 over less. So that's why we call reciprocal. So if this is time, and then this is corresponding to frequency. And actually in physics, this is called spatial frequency. This means that from real lattice to reciprocal lattice is a pure transform. But anyway, we're not talking about this one. This is for mathematics, this is what it does. Okay. And next, you can check the angle between B1 and B2. So the angle between B1 and B2, you forgot actually the first one, but this one. So the angle between B1 and B2, in fact, is the cosine theta. It's given by, remember, so remember this one, right? So B1 dot is B2 divided by the magnitude of B1 dot is B2. So this is the angle. So that's why for this case, B1 dot is B2. Basically, we use this one, right? So this is B1, B2. So, here. So 1 over A, 1 over A, anyway, you can cancel out, just ignore it. And then you have 1, right? This is 1, 0, 0, 1. So you have 1. And then magnitude also 1. B1, B2, right? And so that's why you have 1. It's pretty red. It's something wrong somewhere. Right? That's what you get. two, we have three vector functions as function of t, right? So this means that f is a function of t. We need to show that E dt, this is very difficult, sorry, because you were going to use this one, but somehow it ran off the battery, that's why it's very difficult to write. Prove this. So we just write down this one first. So this is actually we have to do it, step by step. Okay. So this is a cross product, right? So you have I and j and then k. Okay. So you have so f one. F2 and then F3. So you have T1, T2, T3. So these are basically the three components, right? So now we just need to find out what this is going to do, right? So to simply discuss it right here. So this, we have three components, right? So you have F2, T3. Minus F3 T2, and then you have F3 T1 minus F1 and then T3, and then you have F1 T2 minus F2 T1. So that's the cross product, right? So differentiate this one with respect to T. So differentiate this one with respect to t means that you have to differentiate these three components, right? So since I don't have much space, what I'll do is that I just differentiate this one, and then I just put the prime here, and then after that I just need to differentiate these three components. This means that I have to differentiate this one. So that's why this basically is equal to, I just look at this one now, and so I have differentiated this one and this one, right? So that's why I have F2 prime G3 plus F2 and then G3 prime, right? So minus F3 prime G2 and then minus F3 prime. So that's the first component. And the second one, you have F3 prime G1 plus f3 t1 prime minus f1 prime t3 and then minus f1 t2 prime. Right, you have 4, right? It's okay. So after that, so you have f1 prime t2 plus f1 t2 prime then minus f2 prime t1 and then minus f2 t1 prime. That's okay, right? Right. Okay, so now I try to group this one. Is it okay? Anyway, literally you have all these terms anyway, right? So now I just look at this one. And so all the ones with f prime, this one, and then this one, so this one, and then this one. Okay? So this is one group. The next group is the one with g prime, this one. Right? So that's why if you write down this and see for them, if you want me to rewrite this, I can always do this. So I just write whatever is f prime g3 and then f3 prime f3 and then g2 prime. Right? And then I have f3 prime t1 and then minus f1 here you need to, because this writing looks like between the one that you cannot see very clearly. But anyway, eventually you should have another term pick up from here. Okay? So f3 t1 prime, right? And then from the last four terms you have f1 prime g2 minus f1 and then g2 prime. So this is the one, and then plus another one. So you have f2 and g3 prime minus f2 prime and g3, and then this one is called f3 g is it messed up, right? Not that it's right. Write down a little bit okay, anyway. Let me check this again. So the first one is okay, the group is okay. The second one, when we group this, this will be also okay, right? Yeah, it's okay. So this one will group with this one, this one group with this one. F1, F2, yeah. So this one will group with this one, right? So I will not write this one. So all this is put together, you will see that this actually exactly is F prime cross G. Okay, you try to write down this one, you get all the terms. Yeah. And then the next one, if you try to write down, F1 cross G. Next one, you write down, you can have an F cross G prime. It means that, okay, all these six terms, this one, right? And then this one, this come together in this one. There's a prime here, you can see F is prime, but the G is in the original form, right? And then the next six terms, so this one, g, that's a prime, that's a d prime here, and then this one, d prime, and this one, d prime, and so d prime, and d prime, but f in the original form. So you put this six terms together, it's exactly this one. Right? You can try to... It's okay. I could rewrite this one, but this is good. We don't need to write because the pen cannot align very well. Okay. So if you use that one, I think it's a marker because you want to do this one. I didn't know that this is the battery. I just need to do one 2 weeks ago. So it's, I don't know why it's so far. It's okay, right? I will give you a solution after finishing. I'll give you a solution. That's why you only write down, right? And give us the you print it for, okay? That's why you only write down. Just look at this. So next one. So B. So question B is a part B, and we have to perform this. This top product. Right, so we have to prove that this B, D, T, and F dot D cross H. Okay, and we have to prove that this is equal to D, F, D, T dot and D cross H. And then plus F dot DT DT cross H. Okay, and then plus F dot G cross D H DT. Right? These are good. Okay, and to do this, we'll just make use of two of these. So the first one. We'll make use of this one. I think that I will not prove. Remember, we prove this one in the left notes, right? So if we have a dot product of A and then B, and so that's a product rule of DA, DT dot with B plus this A dot this DB, DT, right? So this is what we learned in left notes. And so just right now, we also prove this one, right? We'll make use of this. So A cross B. So this one we just proved, right? It's A, B, A, D, T cross B plus A cross D, B, D, T. So we'll make use of the two, okay? So the first one already proved in the left notes, and the second one is the one we just proved. So if we prove this, so you just call this A, and then this is B, right? And then you have D, the first step you have D, so F, so D cross H, and then given by DF, DT, dot G cross H, then plus F dot D D T, and then D cross H, right? So in the first term, so we just write here. So we have this one. So G cross H, and the second one, and so you make use of this one. Right, so you have F dot, and so you have a bracket here, and so DT, DT cross H plus G cross DH, DT, right, and then you just put that in, so the first term is still here, so don't change it, right, and the second one. The dot product can dispute, right? Dispute this in. So you have a DT, DT, dt across the tangent. And then plus f dot d across d tangent. Dt, right? So that basically is this one. So you just basically you use this is what we have learned, right? The substitute, right? You get this. It's okay, right? It's okay, right? So this is what you have. So next we have to we have to prove that dt, f cross d cross h, right? So it proves that this is given by df dt cross d cross h plus f cross dt dt cross h, and then plus f cross t cross dh dt, right? So again, in this case, we just make use of this. So b b cross d dt, right? So this is given by dA cross dt cross b plus a cross dt dt, right? So now you just consider this as a and this as b, right? And then you have so this is equal to the left hand side, right? So you have df dt cross d cross h, and then plus f cross dt. So it's same as the previous case, right? It's just now you have a double triple product, let's say, right? So this one you just write down. And then just distill this in, right? So this f is still here, so now this one, you have dt cross h, and then plus t cross d h, dt, right? So now, just rewrite this one anyway, so you see, t cross h, right? And then plus n cross dt cross h, and then cross b, and then we have it. So this basically is the same as this one, right? So we didn't do anything, we just use this one, we use this twice, right? And then just get this one, right? This is what you are having. Okay, next one. So d, we have to prove that f is a vector function. So we have to prove that this is given by f. So it's the magnitude of f, okay? F magnitude f multiplied by f. Right? This is what I do it. Okay. So to prove this, remember f is a vector function of t, right? Now, it always be written as a union vector function in this direction multiplied by the magnitude of this. Any vector can be written in this form, right? So any vector can be written as a union vector in its own direction, multiplied by its own magnitude. Right? That's basically a vector, right? You always do that. Okay? So now, if you understand this, so now we try to left hand side. So this is given by f, which we just write here, right? Dot base. So now you have d f union vector, magnitude of f, and and then E key, right? We can do that, right? So, and then F basically is still here. And then, so remember, we learned this. The first order derivative of a vector function multiplied by a scalar function. So E is a scalar function, E is a vector function. So this is given by EA, ET, multiplied by E is a scalar function, that's right, like this, plus A, EE, ET. Right? That's with, and this is one of the formula we learned is in the lecture, so you can check, right? So now just make use of this, and then you have two terms. So you have a E F unit vector ET, right? And then this is a unit vector, by the way, and then magnitude of F. So we didn't do anything, right? And then plus unit vector of F, and then D magnitude of this vector, ET, right? Oh, yeah, right? So now remember, we just threw this in, F is given by F unit vector multiplied by F, right? So that is this one. And then we just threw in, so you have the first term, EF unit vector, ET, and the dot product is from here, right? And then the magnitude of F plus F unit vector, right? F magnitude dot F unit vector, and then EF magnitude ET is okay, right? So now remember, in the lecture notes, we also prove that if A is a unit vector, and then this is always perpendicular to its own first order derivative. This is the lecture notes you can go back and check. So this is always zero. Right? So why this is the case? Remember how we prove this one? That's because that A dot A, B vector dot unit vector, is zero. Why? Because the A unit vector dot unit vector is one. Right? It's a constant, right? Dot zero. And from here, you use product rule, and then you can prove this. So this means that this vector is perpendicular to this vector, because the F is unit vector in both cases. That's why the first term dot product gives zero. And second term, and you know, if you want, you can, you know, just rearrange this one. So you grab this one first, the magnitude of this one, and then you have unit vector dot this F unit vector, and then the D F magnitude, and then E T. And remember, this one is one, right? Just like this. So E unit vector dot unit vector is one, right? So that's why eventually you have F magnitude. There's no dot anymore because both are scalar functions, dt, right? And then by definition, this f a magnitude is simply defined as f. That's it. So that's why I have f e f e t, right? So that is right. That's how we should. So that's why for unit vector, remember, this is a very useful relationship. So unit vector is always perpendicular to this first order derivative. It's always the case, whatever unit vector you have, right? You always need this property, okay? So last one, we have to prove this. ET, F vector function dot base EF ET, and then cross the second order derivative of this. I have to prove that this is equal to F dot F E T cross E F D cube, sorry. Cube. E T cube. Right? That's what I found out. Okay? So again, this left hand side. We use a product rule because we have one vector dot with another vector, right? So that's why we just need to differentiate this one, okay, and dot this by itself, CFDT cross D square F DT square F, and then plus F dot with DEDT and then DF DT cross D square F DT square, right? So okay, the first one is zero. So why is zero? Because this DT DF DT cross this one is always perpendicular to this one, right? So that's a the property is if you see here A cross B is a vector, right? It's always perpendicular to A and also perpendicular to B. So the product of any vector is perpendicular to both vectors, right? So that's how cross product is defined, right? So that's why whenever in this case, EFDT cross this one must be perpendicular to one of them. So basically EFDT, right? So that's why this is zero, the first one, right? So the second one, and then you have F dot this. So now you have two terms, right? So you differentiate this one first, you get second order derivative, because you already have first order derivative, right? And then cross this second order derivative, and then dt squared. So that's the first one. Then plus, so you leave this one here, which is still the first order derivative, but the second one becomes third order derivative, right? Because it's already second order derivative, right? So now you can see that this one is zero, because any vector cross with itself is always zero, right? Does that in the same direction? It's always zero. So that's why you only have F dot with EF DT cross this square, sorry, cube, third order derivative. Right? So this is the, so this is over to the right hand side. Right. So that's how that's about question 3. Okay. Then we go to question 4. Question 3, show that the first derivative of vector function A can decompose into two components which are perpendicular and parallel to A respectively, and find the two components. Okay. So any vector function, so we have part A, right? Any vector function A can be written as a unit vector multiplied by the magnitude of the vector, right? That's always true for any vector. Okay. So now we try to differentiate this one. The question asks you to show that the first order derivative of this can be written into two components, right? So one is parallel to itself, the other one perpendicular. So we just need to differentiate this one. It's like P. So basically, it's like P, DT, and then you have A unit vector, and then A magnitude, right? So again, you have a unit vector, DT, magnitude of A plus union vector then E magnitude B dT, right? So now you see that we already explained this right now, right? So A unit vector is always perpendicular to A unit vector for the other coordinate, right? So this means that look at this component. So this component is perpendicular to A, right? And then this component, of course, is parallel to A, right? Because it's in this unit vector direction, right? So this means that we answer the first part of the question, means that the first order derivative of this one can always decompose into two components. So one is parallel to A, and the other perpendicular to A, right? So what's the parallel component? The question asks you, what's the parallel component? So the parallel component, basically, is given by, this means that dA dT, okay, parallel. Parallel means the parallel to A, right? So this component, because this is a vector, once you represent it into this form, this means it's a scalar, it's a component, it's a scalar. So that basically is A magnitude dT. So that's coming from here, because this is a unit vector, right? And then what about the perpendicular component? So dA dT, perpendicular component, again, must be a scalar, right? So that's given by the magnitude of this unit vector, first order derivative unit vector, and the magnitude. So that's a component, right? So because this one is not a unit vector, A hat is a unit vector, but dA hat dT is not a unit vector, it has a magnitude. So that's why the perpendicular component basically is given by this. And it's in a direction which is perpendicular to A, right? But this is the parallel component, right? So this means that, remember, when we talk about any vector, remember, we think this one, right? It's a constant vector, remember. But any constant vector, you can decompose this one into two components, right? In the two components, which are perpendicular to each other. So this is a parallel component, and this is perpendicular, right? And then, so your dA dT is a vector function, but anyway, so see, if this is dA dT, so this is dA dT, right? And you have an infinite number of ways to decompose this one into two components which are perpendicular to each other. But the natural way to do that is by this. So that's why eventually you have one component which is in A direction, but never in A initially in this direction, right? But the dA prime dT is not in A direction, right? And then another one is perpendicular to this. So this means that you decompose this one into two components, one is parallel and one is perpendicular, right? So the parallel component is given by this, and then the perpendicular component is by this. That's the basic way, right? So I hope you can understand this. Right? So any vector can do this. And then B, this I already explained actually, but you just need to look at it again. So if I can ask you, and if vector function A satisfies this requirement, and then what kind of vector function is A? This means that what kind of property does B have if it satisfies this, right? So, and again, we go back to use previous the solution for the previous question. So remember, we can decompose this one into A unit vector dA magnitude dT, and then plus dA hat dT, and then magnitude of A. Right? We can do that. This is for zero. Thank you. legend right here, okay? So so now if I, you know, just distribute this in to this one and then see what you get. You get A magnitude, right? Because A dot, A unit vector is A magnitude. And then you have dA magnitude dt, right? And then you distribute this one in, you get zero because the A unit vector and then dA unit vector is the same, is a perpendicular, that's why I get this zero, right? And then from here, you can see that you can have two cases. So either magnitude of this one is zero, or the rate of change of the magnitude is zero, right? So the first case called trivial solution, what we call is the case that we're not interested in. That's because if the magnitude is zero, it means that the vector is not defined anywhere. That's so that's why we are interested in the second case. So second case, this means that this vector has a constant magnitude because the magnitude is not changing. This means that if vector A satisfies this condition, it means that it has a constant magnitude. That's the first part. So it means the question asks you, if A satisfies this condition, and so what kind of vector is A? And then, so our answer is, if A satisfies this, this means that this vector has a constant magnitude. Because magnitude, rate of change of magnitude is like T0. Magnitude is not changing, right? So this means, this is not difficult to understand. You know why? Because if an emperor, this is a, if the magnitude of this vector not changing, this means that this vector immediately will trace a circle, right? Because this vector is just good at this, right? So in this case, you see the magnitude not changing, right? So, and then rate of change of this, so basically remember, rate of change is the difference. See from here, and then to here, so this one. So when this angle approaches zero, and then this basically is a tangent vector to this a circle. So this tangent vector and this vector is always perpendicular to each other, right? So this tangent vector is the rate of change, and this is the vector itself at this point. So that's why the dot product must be zero. Right, so this means that if you have a constant magnitude, and then the rate of change of this vector is always perpendicular to itself, right? Because amplitude cannot change. So that is the idea. Okay, and then we look at the next one. So the next one, so what happens and if A satisfies this? Right. So again, we just rewrite this one as cross this A D D again is an A unit vector, right? And then D A magnitude C T, and then plus and D A unit vector D T, and then magnitude of A, right? So this is equal to zero. And then we distribute this in, so you get the. And the first term is zero, right? Because the A cross A unit vector, because they are in the same direction. That's why this is zero, right? And then you have dA under A cross dA dt, or this is A unit vector, dA n. And then the magnitude of A, right? So this is zero, okay? Remember, so this one can be written as A magnitude A hat unit vector, right? Cross D A hat D T, and then this one, magnitude, right? So eventually, it's A cross D A hat D T A magnitude square over zero, right? So we are not interested in the case that A magnitude is zero, right? So assume this is not equal to zero. Because if this is zero, again, is a dot, but now it is this. So that's why the only possibility is this one cross this is zero, right? Then remember, A hat is always perpendicular to, perpendicular to itself, right? So this means this cross product right here is the magnitude of A hat and the magnitude of EA hat, ET, and then multiplied by unit vector. So this unit vector is A cross ET because they're perpendicular to each other. There's no angle between the two, right? So this is zero. And then of course, this, that only two situations. One is this one zero, but this one is one. That's the unit vector. That's why the only possibility is this one. It's zero. That's the only possibility. Right? So that means that the dA hat dt is zero. That's the only possibility, right? So this means that the dA hat dt is zero. Then what does this mean? This means that the direction of this function cannot change. Right? So it means that if you satisfy this one, and this vector function can only change if, you know, t length you know, can be smaller or whatever, but it must be in the same direction. Right? So if in the same direction, you can see that the rate of change, so dAdt, if it's in the same direction, and then dAdt is always parallel to A. It's not unit vector, sorry. Now it's not unit vector, by the way. Unit vector is a vector function itself. So this means that if this is the case, means that this direction cannot change. Direction cannot change means that at different t, your this A can only change in length, but it cannot change direction. If you only change in length, and then dAdt is always in the same direction. So if it's in the same direction, means this one parallel. With a parallel, of course, the product is always zero, right? So this means that if the rate of change of this function is parallel to itself, means that this function and this vector function has a constant direction, right? And then if dot product zero means that this vector function has a constant magnitude. That's in the first case, right? So that is the question. Okay. Can we just stop here, please? Or type of thing is the other group. Stop here, please. Finish. You want to finish? Huh? Yeah, you. Huh? You want to finish? Okay, so let's go to finish 5 or 4. Yes or no? So how many of you want to finish? Okay, let's just back over here.
Yeah.
You want to go back?
Yes.
So how many of you want to go back?
Yes, very tired.
Very tired. Oh, majority. okay, so here we
continue. 一个人的东西，没人讲过。